Hello, I'm Neil Harl, professor of economics at Iowa State University. This is the first in a series on organization of the farm business, on farm business planning, if you will. For many farm families, it's a relatively rare occasion to undertake a full dress examination of the choices available to them in how they organize their farm business. In fact, for many farm families, they may have, during their entire lives, functioned, say, as a sole proprietorship from the time they started farming until retirement. For others, they may have been involved in a partnership, perhaps with another family member, and continue that structure on until retirement. And for some, they may have made use of the corporation all those years. But for an increasing segment of farm families, they're raising the question as to whether the way they're organized now is really the best way for them to be structured. And there may be a number of reasons why they raise these questions. There may be a son or son-in-law who'd like to come back to the operation. And in the process of trying to figure out a way to create a place for them in the operation, they're examining the choices open to them. Maybe they should be changing the organizational structure for the farm business. Or it may be rising income, and income tax concerns may loom large. They may also be concerned because of estate planning considerations or pressures. The parents may be in the process of trying to decide how to dispose of the assets during life, at death, or both, and in the process may be reviewing or really considering the review of other ways to organize the farm business that might make their estate planning process a little bit easier. With the choices open to them, they can then, at various points along the way, decide whether the way they're organized is really the best for them. But because of the red tape involved, and because of the cost involved, rarely do they do this very many times during their farming careers. Now, in our series, we'll be examining the basic choices open to them. And let's examine quickly those choices, and then let's also take a look at the features of each we'll be examining as we proceed along. We're going to be looking at the sole proprietorship. Always been the most common, almost a dominant form of organization in agriculture. In fact, more than 80% of the farm businesses are organized in sole proprietorship form. It's the simplest of all. The partnership, both general partnership and limited partnership, also used in agriculture. The general partnership is more commonly used than the limited partnership, but there certainly is a place, some farm businesses, for the limited partnership as a way at least to hold maybe the land and make it available to the operating side of the farm business. More on that in a later program. The corporation will also be a focus for our discussion. We'll be looking at the regularly taxed corporation, also looking at the so-called tax option or subchapter S method. Now, for each of those choices, we're going to be looking at an array of considerations, and we'll almost be treating this as a scorecard. We'll be coming back from time to time to put up some pluses and minuses in terms of whether a particular choice, say the sole proprietorship, merits a plus or a minus as to a particular feature or characteristic. We're going to be looking at the formation of the farm business in each of those forms. We're going to be considering the red tape involved, the cost involved. We'll be moving on in each case to look at the income tax considerations, the treatment of ordinary income, capital gain, investment credit. We'll be looking at management and control. Who makes the decisions? How does it differ as we move from the sole proprietorship to the partnership to the corporation? We'll be examining the risks and how they are shared, how they are borne. Who bears the risk if we have a massive accident or if incomes are down? Who will be gaining, who will be losing, as the case may be? Now, at that same time, we'll be concerned about division of income within the family, and it may proceed along somewhat parallel to the way the risks and the liabilities are in fact borne. And we'll be considering, in those instances where it's relevant, employee status, and it certainly is relevant in the corporation. In terms of financial considerations, how we develop the financial structure, we'll be examining this especially for the partnership and the corporation. And for the corporation, looking at the use of equity capital, ownership, risk capital, as well as debt capital. The transfer of ownership, certainly an important estate planning consideration, and how the ownership of assets can be transferred on from one generation to the next. The matter of dissolution, How do we get out of a particular organizational structure if we find out later that really isn't the way that we should be organized? So those will be our focus. Those will be our areas of emphasis for the remaining programs in this series. As we look at all those choices and all those considerations, we might ask the question, how do you decide in your particular case which is the best one? And it's a very difficult choice in many, many cases. And it's not very helpful for us to say at this point that there is no perfect organizational choice or organizational structure. A particular organizational structure is only perfect as it does the best job of accomplishing your objectives. That's the only perfect organizational choice that we could identify. And so that means that we should take a look at your particular objectives, the objectives that ought to guide the planning process. Before we get into the matter of objectives, one additional point we should make as a matter of introduction, and that is that we believe rather firmly that business planning, which will be our focus in this series, ought to be undertaken at the same time you examine the estate planning aspects as well. Because in most farm families, the two are very closely intertwined. In fact, it's very artificial to try to separate out the estate planning problem from the business planning problem. And if this is the year that you want to solve your business planning problems, to address your business planning concerns, if you do that, but you don't undertake an examination of the estate planning problems as well, you may discover a decade from now that you may have to back up and undo or redo what you did back in this particular year. And the reverse is true also. So we believe the two ought to be solved together. Now for a quick look at objectives. In the usual farm family situation, there will be multiple sources of objectives. And the way we examine those sources of objectives, that is to say the parents together, the parents as individuals, and the children, will somehow relate to whether it's thought the farm business will continue or not beyond the lifespan of the parents. Now let's examine those choices, or those sources of objectives first. The parents together will typically have a number of objectives, like they want to be sure that they're well taken care of in terms of security of income and in security of capital, especially difficult in a time of high rates of inflation. But whether they live to be 85 or 115, the parents want to be sure that their income is assured. They also want to be fair to the children, typically. And that is more difficult to achieve if the farm business continues on, or it's hoped the farm business will continue on into the next generation. Because if the farm business is going to terminate at the retirement or death of the parents, then it is not so terribly important to involve the children in the decision-making to as intimate a degree, because after all, the property may be sold and the proceeds divided anyway. And so where it's planned for the farm business to terminate, it may not be so crucial as where it's planned for the farm business to continue, and the continuation of the capital, the entire amount of capital together, meaning that the off-farm heirs capital included as well, will make it very important the parents involve the children, all of them, in the decision-making process. The parents together will also want to be concerned usually about saving taxes and estate settlement costs as all the property is moved through their estates. And then we ask the question, what about objectives held by the parents individually? For example, the wife may be concerned about her right to income. The wife may be interested in having a particular place, a niche in the farm business organizational structure, so that over time she has a right to the income, and that can lead to a buildup of an estate of her own. She may be also concerned about management if she survives. The husband may be concerned about other considerations. The husband may be concerned about the possibility that if he dies first, there might be a successor spouse on the scene. And so we need to examine whether there are some deeply held, deeply felt objectives by the parents' individuals. And then the children, if given half a chance, and sometimes even not given half a chance, will be glad to outline their objectives. And here we can divide the children into two basic groups, the on-farm heir group and the off-farm heir group. And the on-farm heir group will typically have about three major objectives in mind. The on-farm heirs will usually be concerned about sharing of income. They'd like to have a fair division of income. And that is especially important when we stop to think that the parents will gradually be phasing out of the operation, certainly in terms of their labor, in terms of their management input. And so as that happens, the on-farm heirs are concerned about a gradual adjustment in the income sharing arrangement so that it continues to be fair. The on-farm heirs are also concerned about an opportunity to invest, to increase their equity capital share in the operation. Again, especially important in a time of inflation to establish a strong equity position so that they can benefit from increases in the general price level. The on-farm heirs are also concerned about management. This is actual day-to-day farm business decision-making. Now, the off-farm heirs have a different set of concerns. The off-farm heirs are concerned typically about being locked into the operation. They fear time when they might find their inheritance committed to the operation, may not be able to remove it, 10, 15, 20 years, or maybe even more. And so that tends to be a high priority concern for the off-farm heirs. They're also typically concerned about their income, right? If they do leave their capital in the operation, are they going to be receiving some return on it? And will it be coming out as ordinary income, or will it be capital gain? Certainly that's important to a high tax bracket off-farm heirs, And then thirdly, the off-farm heirs are concerned about decision-making. They're not concerned about farm management decision-making. They're more concerned about financial decision-making. Who makes the decisions on how the income is divided as between themselves and the on-farm heirs after the death of parents? So as we look at all these objectives from the various sources, we can just about divide farm businesses into three groups. And this is important, I think, to us in guiding us through the planning process. The first group are those farm businesses where it's thought the farm business will terminate at the retirement or death of the parents. Now, if that's the case, then the prime source of objectives will be the parents. Children may not be as deeply involved in the process as if it's thought the farm business will continue. The second small but growing group of farm businesses. And if that's the case, then it may be very important to involve the children in the decision-making process because they may actually be investors together for a period of time. The third group of farm businesses are those where they simply haven't yet made up their mind as to whether their particular farm business will be continuing or not on to the next generation and may not make that decision for some years. Typically, that's the younger family. Next time, in the next program segment, we will be examining further the question of the movement of the parents out of the operation, the family farm cycle, considering what this really means to us in terms of beginning to make some basic choices in how the farm business is organized. If you're thinking about changing the organizational structure of your farm business, you might ask the question, do you think there's a possibility that your farm business may continue as a going economic entity on into the next generation? Is that a realistic possibility? Or is it more likely that your farm business will terminate at your retirement, possibly at your death? If the latter is your response, that there's a fairly good chance that your farm business will terminate, you might want to consider or raise the question whether, even though it may terminate, there's a possibility that between now and the time that it terminates, you might be involved in helping a child, a son, or son-in-law become established in farming. We're going to look at two possible parent-child relationships based upon that possibility. One of these we call the spin-off model, the other the landlord-tenant relationship. Now there's a third parent-child arrangement that we're going to be mentioning, and that we call the super firm. And that's the situation where there is a continuation or a hope, a thought, a goal of continuing the farm business on into the next generation so that there is a rather long-term relationship of parent and child in the same farm business. Let's go back now and take a look at the so-called spin-off model. This is an arrangement whereby the parents create an opportunity for a child who wishes to come back into the operation to have an opportunity to get started. It may start off with an employer-employee arrangement. And the son may be receiving, or the child may be receiving, a little more than a wage in the beginning, then perhaps a wage plus some sort of a bonus arrangement, and that may mature into a profit-sharing plan of some type. Oftentimes, with a spin-off arrangement, the child will begin to accumulate his or her own economic base, begin to build up some equipment, begin to acquire some land. Parents are helpful. They permit the child to use the parents' equipment on the child's land that the children have been able to rent. Perhaps the parents will co-sign a note, stand behind them financially, may even put in a good word with the landlords in the neighborhood who own all the land so the children can obtain the rental of some land. But the spin-off model is a rather short-term arrangement, 3 years, possibly 5 years, rarely more than 10. And as soon as the children can, as soon as they've developed their own economic base sufficiently, they spin off into their own economic orbit. And at that point, the parents' operation starts that long, slow decline toward oblivion. Many times, the parent-child arrangement of the spin-off model type is oral in nature. In fact, most of them are oral in nature. We do believe that there's a great deal of merit in reflecting the agreements reached in writing. Two basic reasons why. One is that a written agreement specifying, laying out what the parents and the children have agreed upon will encourage agreement over a greater array of issues and concerns. They may take up the question of what happens if someone dies prematurely as they're moving through this period of 3, 5, 7, or 10 years. How they divide the income during this period, what the rights of the child or children might be with respect to income generated by the operation, and so on. So that we see in the written arrangement a greater likelihood that they will have considered most of the major matters of concern that could come up later on and possibly cause disagreements. The second reason why we think it's well to have a written agreement between parent and child where there's a spin-off type arrangement going is that it tends to combat what we call the selective recall syndrome. People tend to remember best those things that support their point of view, and remember less well or not at all those things that don't support their point of view. And that's why you can find people arguing in perfect good faith, head-to-head, 20 years after a key conversation took place, about what was agreed upon at that time. If their agreements were memorialized in writing, then they can go back, refer to that document, and settle the problems that arise within the basic rules and guidelines laid down at the time they entered into the arrangement. So that we certainly would suggest that there is merit in having these in writing. The spin-off model may create problems if there are some unexpected events that might develop or that do develop during the period that it's functioning. That is to say, if there were to be, say, death of the parents, it might create a situation of some jeopardy for the children, because there might then be division of all the parents' property among all the heirs and leave the child striving to become established in farming with an inadequate amount of capital to continue on. Death of the child might create a jeopardy situation with respect to the economic situation for that child's family. So we suggest careful consideration of all events that might happen during the period of relationship between parent and child, including the possibility of deaths occurring. The second parent-child arrangement we might mention is the landlord-tenant style, landlord-tenant type. This is especially attractive for those parents who are getting close enough to retirement, to Social Security benefits, so that they're willing to pull back, play the role of the landlord, rent the land to the child as a tenant, perhaps helping to finance the child's purchase of half the livestock, half the machinery, perhaps so that the child can start off with a livestock share lease. Then as the child builds up capital, can move into a position of full purchase of the machinery and the livestock so that can operate within the general setting of a crop share lease. And eventually, then the children might very well begin to purchase the land as well. The landlord-tenant type arrangement can work quite well, particularly for older parents, but there are a couple of problems we might mention. The parents may be unhappy that the income, their income from the operation, may be less than they were receiving before they changed the arrangement to include the children as the tenant in the operation, because they're essentially dividing the income from the same operation but over an additional family. They've added a family without perhaps increasing the scale of operation, and so they should realize that there may very well be a reduction of income to them. Secondly, there may be a problem of the parents playing the role of a landlord in terms of their management input. After a few years, may begin to hear some gentle grumbling. The children, the tenant may say, tenants may say, you know, my friend up the road has a lease just like mine, and he doesn't have to endure this gratuitous commentary about why my cornrows are crooked, or why I'm not out there cutting weeds when it rains, or other kinds of suggestions made by the parents. Parents cannot understand why this is a problem, but it may not be in keeping with the usual landlord-tenant sharing of management input. And so after a while, this could become a corrosive matter, and it can, in some cases, lead to a breakup of the operation. So it's well to keep that problem in mind. The third type of parent-child arrangement we refer to as the superfirm. This is the one in which it's thought, hoped, it's a matter of their objectives, the farm business will continue as a going economic entity beyond the lifespan of the parents. And because there is a hope that it'll continue to function beyond the parents' lifespan, there will be periods in which there will be more than one owner of the resources involved. There will be periods in which both the parents and the children are involved in ownership of the assets. The parents may be reducing their ownership interest while the children are gradually increasing their interest. The parents are phasing out, the children are phasing in. At the same time, there will be multiple involvement in decision-making because, again, the parents are involved in decisions, the parents are gradually phasing out of decision-making, and the children are phasing in. So with an expectation that there will be multiple involvement in decision-making and multiple ownership of resources, in the typical superfirm situation, they are inclined to turn toward the partnership, general or limited partnership, and the small closely held corporation because those devices do easily encompass the features of multiple ownership of resources and multiple participation in the making of decisions. The superfirm arrangement then involves a rather permanent commitment of the children to the home operation. As we think back over these three types of parent-child arrangement, we should mention that it's important that the parents and children have a very clear understanding of which of these they are following. For example, in a recent case in one Midwestern state, after 13 years of operation, the parent-child operation came to a halt. It came to a halt because they could not seem to agree on the question of when the child was going to be able to buy into the operation. When the child was put off and, well, maybe next year or maybe the year after. And after 13 years of that, the child asked the question a bit more forcefully, and when am I going to be able to buy into the operation? Whereupon the parent said, you're not. And at that point, the child picked up his marbles and went home, as it were, and the operation came to a close. Then it came out that the parents, really, all these years, had had a spin-off model in mind, and they couldn't understand why the child passed up the opportunity to pick up a line of used equipment, why the child did not pick up that 80 down the road that came up for rent. Instead, the child always seemed to be interested in adding on to the parents' operation, adding on another confinement unit, another half section that came up for sale across the road, and so on. The child was equally frustrated because after it was all over, the child said, you know, I thought we had a firm commitment that we were going to make something of the old home place, and that was in my mind from the very beginning. So it was clear that they did not even have agreement on the most basic types of understandings. As you reflect then upon the question of involvement increasingly by the children, we can perhaps highlight one particular point that is quite important, and that is the opportunities that may exist for the children to buy into the operation, certainly in a super firm arrangement. It's important to recognize that there are two rather different styles of investment, of purchase of assets by the children. One of these we call the minimum risk strategy. With this approach, the child, as funds are available, will purchase assets or interest in assets, and over the years will gradually build up an ownership interest. Now, that minimum risk strategy will lead to a rather slow but gradual shift of ownership from parent to child. Over a period of years, with inflation occurring, the child may not be as far along, say after 20 years, as the friend down the road who followed a maximum risk strategy, who leveraged as far as possible, leveraged to the hilt early, borrowed as much money as possible, either from the parents or from outside creditors, established as great a position as possible in ownership of resources, and then as price levels went up, then that child in the maximum risk situation did very well indeed. And so we should realize that this choice between a minimum risk approach and a maximum risk approach may really end up with quite different outcomes after a period of 10 or 15 or 20 years. So in creating an opportunity for the children to buy in, it's certainly very important to do so. And that, of course, should be undertaken in light of the family farm cycle, where traditionally we've thought about the farm business being born, reaching a peak of operating efficiency, and then declining in efficiency each generation. Increasingly, for those who think in terms of the super firm, there has been interest in seeing if they can perpetuate the peak efficiency of mid-cycle, so that the farm business, once built up to that efficient operating level that typically is reached somewhere near mid-phase in the life cycle, could continue on into the next generation, bringing in then overlapping cycles for the individuals involved, bringing in a son, bringing in perhaps a grandson, grandchild, so that the farm business then does not decline in efficiency late in the life of each generation, the persons from each of those generations. It is not to say that you can avoid changes in efficiency in the farm business within each generation, as there is a shift from, say, parents on into children and then grandchildren, but it may avoid those great declines in efficiency that typically have accompanied the end of the farm business. And so we'll be continuing on examining some of the basic questions of structuring the farm business in the next program. We'll be right back.